to say good afternoon to everyone. On behalf of the family and everyone that's here, we want to thank everyone for coming today. I covet your prayers. I hope I can hold up because this hit home because one thing is family. And I want to thank Miss Abbott for that beautiful arrangement, playing there. So beautiful. I want to thank the directors for everything they've done. And if you sent a card or you said a kind word, the family wants to thank you. And thank you for all your donations. Austin Stacy Castle, 24, passed away Monday, July the 13th, 2020, at the UK Medical Center in Lexington. He was born December the 19th, 1985 in Lexington, Kentucky, to Angela Settles Cobb and Adam Stacy Castle. Austin was an assistant manager at Long John Silver's in Berea. He was always thought to be the best of, or he always thought the best of everyone. To know him was to love him. And he's always willing to help everyone. And if you knew Austin, you knew that. Austin loved to play practical jokes and was the life of the party, always wanting to be with his friends and family. He loved fishing and especially loved his nephews like they were his children. Other than his parents, he is survived by his sister, Adrina Castle of Berea, Kentucky, his maternal grandparents, Aunt Deborah and Uncle Paul Becknell of Waco, Kentucky, and Alex Eugene Settles of Berea, Kentucky, parental grandparents, Debbie and James Lawson of Waco, Kentucky, maternal aunt, Paula Tudor, parental uncles, Scotty Castle, and Chuck Castle, three nephews, Colton, Bryson, and Wesley, and five cousins, Randall, Tyler, Kristen, Grayson, and Dylan. No strange to you. tempted and tried. We're oft made to wonder why it should be thus all the day long. While there are others living about us, never molested, though in the wrong. I like this right here. Farther along we'll know all about it. Farther along we'll understand why. Cheer up, my brother, live in the sunshine. We'll understand it all by and by. When death has come and taken our loved ones, it leaves our home so lonely and drear. Then do we wonder why others prosper, living so wicked year after year? Oh, but farther along we'll know all about it. Farther along we'll understand why. Cheer up, my brother, live in the sunshine. We'll understand it all by and by. Faithful to death said our loving master, few more days to labor and wait. Tolls of the road will then seem as nothing as we sweep through that beautiful gate. When we see Jesus coming in glory, when he comes from his home in the sky, then we shall meet him in that bright city. We'll understand it all by and by. That's one thing for sure. You'll understand all by and by. I wrote a few things down this morning, and seems like it's been one of those times that we've had to just continually be in prayer, because I know my family's hearts were broke. I want to try my best today for Austin and the family that's left behind and those that are here today to pay your respects to this little fella and his family. Austin loved everybody. He never met a stranger. Cynthia was telling me, she shared with me, she went through the drive-thru at Long John Silver's, and she looked at him and said, "You don't know me, do you?" And She said no. And Cynthia's had this thing for 35 years living with me that everybody comes up to her and she says, they say, "You're Randy Crispin's wife, ain't you?" Mm-hmm. They don't know her by Cynthia, they know her by Randy Crispin's wife. Mm-hmm. So she goes through the drive-thru and she tells him that she's Bobby and Sue's daughter-in-law. And he said, "I just love that Sue and Bobby." And he did that. That was him. And I love the fishing pictures that that they put up last night. He loved fishing. He was kind-hearted, a very, very hard worker at Long John Silver's, and it's been said that he was the best there, and he was. He talked to the bosses, and they said he could run that store by himself. So I don't understand this, why it happened, but it's like that song. We'll understand it better by and by. When the call came, my heart broke. It just sank within me. And I'm probably too old-fashioned for a lot of you, but I believe in prayer. And I believe prayer changes things. And there's one thing that moves God, and that is prayer. All through the Bible, it's biblical. It works if it's done right. And all I could do was just pray, Deborah, for the family. And mom was so brokenhearted she couldn't even call me. She had to have Robin to call me. And I had no words to say because it was such a shock. And all I could do was pray. And Monday passed, and all I kept doing, Deborah, was just praying and kept on praying. And I don't know how y'all feel about this, but I'm going to take my experience with Austin. And I hope it helps you, because my heart was broke. Not like the families, because I've never faced anything like this. And people come up to you and they say, "Oh, we know what you're going through. Except you've experienced this, you can't say that with a true heart." Our hearts are broke, but until you've experienced something like this, you can't say really that you know how it feels. But with the family and it being so close to home, Deborah, I felt like I felt a lot of it. And Monday passed, and I just kept on praying. Tuesday passed, all day Tuesday. I'd go to the carport and pray. I'd go downstairs and pray. And I couldn't get any peace with myself. And Tuesday night, and in a vision, in a dream, came to me. And I was laying there, and I got up about 2:00. And today, you may have came for a long-winded message, but I'm just going to share my heart with you, because that's all I know to do first, is share my heart with you. And in a dream, he was laying in this hospital bed, and Jesus came down and stood beside his bed. And when Jesus stuck his arms under his little body like that right there, Austin went down as a baby. And I'm a firm believer that it's going to take a born-again experience according to the scriptures to see God. And I believe he gave me clarity that night. Austin had time to pray between the point that they picked him up and the time they got him to the hospital. I don't recommend that. I don't recommend waiting that late. But we do not know his final words. And I believe today Jesus reached down and saved Austin that night in that hospital. I needed clarity on it. I needed some help. And I hope that helps you today and brings you comfort. When he stood by him, this is so true. When you call on him and repent, of your sins. You don't have to be in a church to accept. You don't have to be in a crowd full of people to accept the Lord. Honey, my pastor got saved in a field out here by Okanite. When you feel that tug and you feel that working around your heart, you need to run to him as fast as you can, because that's him dealing with you. That's him calling you. And I thought, this happens when you want to change your ways and realize the path of sin that you're on is not the direction you want to go. And I just wrote some of that down because Uncle Paul, I wanted to share my heart today, because I felt a burden just to speak. And I had to pray and ask the Lord to help me today. But God's our refuge, and he's our strength. None of us is guaranteed tomorrow. And also, we're not even guaranteed the rest of the day. It's by him. It's not about me and it's not about you, but it's all about him. He controls the very air that we breathe. And none of us is guaranteed that even the next minute. But the Bible pictures, there's several places. I'm not going to go to them all, but you can find in Job and Psalms and James that the Bible pictures life as uncertainties. Life in itself is very uncertain. It causes us to consider its approaching end. And that's where we're at today with Austin. Even though life's uncertainty and death, God has made victory possible. Jesus had power over this. He raised the widow's son. He raised Jairus' daughter. He raised Lazarus. And Jesus overcame death even in his own resurrection. Today, as we grieve, we can look forward to the day that death will be destroyed. There's coming a day there'll never be another funeral. We'll never attend another funeral in heaven. And the rest of our broken hearts will be comforted in God's love. God provides comfort in our sorrow. One reason God sent Jesus down here was to mend our broken hearts and help us go on living. I thought there'll be days, Deborah, that you'll think Austin's going to come and visit. There'll be days, Angie, that you'd like to talk to him. And he won't be there, but he'll be in our memories. And that's very important. Every day of our walk of life, the people that we're around, is to create those precious memories. Because when you're gone, that's the only thing they've got to hang on to, is those precious memories. There's a lesson from the Lord that can be learned here today. And Jesus told them in John, he said, "I am the way, the truth, and the life." Jesus taught us to how to live. We're created in the image of God. We're capable of thinking. We're capable of feeling and willing. With a capacity for knowing him and having fellowship with him, Jesus said this, "And this is eternal life, that they may know thee, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, whom thou hast sent." It matters not how long you live, but how well you live your life. I thought he's prepared himself for this experience. "I lay down my life and take it up again. No one can take this from me, but I lay down my life of my own accord." He died committing his life to God. Jesus also taught us how to live again. He said, "No one comes to the Father except through me." And Christians today are blessed with the presence of Christ. Even with everything that's going on in this world, we're still so blessed with the presence of Christ. I thought, he's with us. He's with us in life. Have y'all ever seen the home interior picture of Jesus holding the little lamb, and he's got it up in his arms, and looks like he's walking around with it? Well, he didn't just pick that little lamb up by itself. There's a story that goes with that. That little lamb had a broken leg, and he picked it up to carry it, because you know why he did that? Because if that little lamb was walking around, the prey would rain on it. The lions, he would become susceptible to the the animal's getting it. So he picked it up. And you know what he'll do today? He'll leave the 99 and come to you if you'll let him. And I feel like that night is what he did for Austin. He left the 99 and came after him. And I just wanted to share that with you today. And he'll do that for us, even in our sorrow. For we know that the promises of our Lord have been fulfilled. Now Paul's words are they're a little stout. He said, "I fought a good fight, and I finished the course, and I've kept the faith." Now after you get saved and after you get the Lord, there's some things that you got to do, and there's more than just the Ten Commandments. The book is filled with commandments of things that we must do to inherit eternal life. But I wanted to share this with you also. There's a little sister in a singing group shared some of these words, and when I turned on my phone, she was a testifying to this song, fixing to sing, and she was testifying. There needs to be a chapter in your life where Jesus comes into it. There needs to be a chapter that you've accepted him as your Lord and Savior. A person outside the family of God, unless he's outside the family of God, unless he's spiritually reborn. We know this. But somewhere in your walk of life, you need to find a few minutes to kneel down and ask the Lord to come into your life. There's two pictures that he used in the Bible that represents this, and it explains it very well. The first one he described in John 3:3 is a born-again experience. The second one is that he referred to in Romans, Galatians, and Ephesians was that adoption. Once you become saved and once you accept the Lord, you become part of the family of God. He refers to time after time in the Bible. We are the sons of God. You're the children of God. And I thought there's a great comfort in knowing that today. So both analogies of this is very true. And it helps us to understand the frequent Bible use of the expressions of the sons of God and the children of God. Jesus said that a person outside the family of God is spiritually condemned unless he is spiritually reborn. The rebirth is accomplished by God's Spirit when a person expresses personal faith in Jesus as one's only hope and forgiveness of sin and life in heaven. The Apostle John said it, "As many as received Jesus, to him he gave the right to become children of God, to those who believe in his name." And I thought, I've used this several times in ministering. There was a child walked up in this rug store. This merchant sold rugs. And he said, there's no pattern on this side. And the merchant told him, said, "Come over to the other side." And he was looking at the back side of the rug instead of the front side of it. And I would invite you today to come over to the right side if you don't know him as your Lord and Savior. I thought, I want to challenge us today to leave here, to leave this funeral, to help this family. I thought the night that Austin was there in the hospital, his life was broken and shattered. And I believe today with all of my heart, if he could come back, he would tell you guys that Jesus picked him up at his lowest point. And I'll leave today, as we go to the cemetery, I'll leave believing that Jesus came on the scene because somebody prayed. He heard somebody's prayers when Austin was at his lowest and in trouble. Somebody prayed for that young man and for this family. I challenge us today to leave this service. Let's honor one another through service. Let's be generous and show our hospitality one to another. I thought we can help build each other's spiritual life up if we will, and not try to tear each other down. We're to teach each other. We're to be truthful. We're to be kind and forgiving. We're to comfort to one another in times of need. And this is probably one of the greatest times that Paul and Deborah and Angie and the family will ever experience. And I want us to I'd like to challenge you today, to each one of us, to live a holy life according to Hebrews 3 and 13 and 10 and 24 and 5. We're to pray for one another. And wanted to help you today. I wanted to try to share those thoughts with you, and it be of comfort to you. And I know today that we're nothing without God. We're nothing without Him. And I don't stand here today just as a minister, but I stand here today as family. And I see friends that I haven't saw in a long time here today, showing their respects and showing their love for Austin's family. Let's bow our heads and pray as I close today. If everyone would. Lord, You're the giver of life. Your Son, Jesus Christ, is the source of our eternal life. You know our hearts, Father. You see our grief. You can give us peace and comfort. Only You can dry our tears today. You can soothe our pain. In our sorrow, we look back and see the cross, but we also see an empty tomb. And how thankful that we are that Jesus rose on that third day, never to die again. We cling to that promise today because You said, I live, you can live also. Thank You, dear Lord, for Your victory over death and for Your grace and the love that You share with us in victory today. Comfort us, Lord, in our time of loss, and deepen our trust in our Savior. Strengthen our resolve to live for Him. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
God bless every one of you, is my prayers.